you all for coming, and thank you, Sylvain, for having invited me for this talk. And sorry for being the first speaker after lunch. I'm sure this is hard, but I will try to keep you awake. Okay, today I will be talking about automatic process planning solutions for additive manufacturing. I'm sure that all of you know exactly what additive manufacturing is, but we recently have discovered that this process planning terminology is somehow exotic in our community. So just think of it for now as the sequence of operations that you do after you have designed the geometry of an object and before you have to print it. So you have to prepare the model. This is what I will be talking about. So I will start just very quickly by introducing myself and my institution. Since all the process planning solutions I will be describing are being developed in the context of a European project, I will briefly describe the project as well. Then I will show you what our academic and industrial partners feel to be critical issues in this pipeline, and then I will show you how we are going to resolve them. So I am a permanent researcher at the National Research Council, which is the largest public research institution in Italy. It is made of institutions that cover all fields of science. My own institution is the Institute for Applied Mathematics and Information Technologies, which is spread in three cities in Italy. And my group is in Genova and deals with computer graphics. And we have also another group that deals with high-performance computing. The Kaxman project I'll be describing has been financed by the European Commission and under the goal Factories of the Future. And it stands for Computer-Aided Technologies for Additive Manufacturing. The objective of this project is to establish cloud-based toolboxes, workflows, and one-stop shop for CAX technologies. So what we want to do is to support the designer, the process planner, the engineer, and the manufacturer, all these persons, through a single access point on the internet. So we want to move all the softwares that you are currently using during the process, the product development pipeline, on the cloud, so that everything becomes as interoperable as possible. This is one a real challenge, but we are trying to do this in this project. The overall idea here is to, we want to be interoperable within the project, but also with the outer world. So we start with the standard representations for geometric models that are used in product development. So we start from a STEM file. This is what current CAD softwares produce. And we first enter a phase of analysis-based design. This means that we, during the design of the part, we also simulate its behavior in terms of mechanical stresses and thermal behavior as the object is built. So we somehow predict how this object will behave in the physical world. When we are happy with that, we pass control to the process planning stage. And the process planning stage is another work package here in the project. This is very central because we cast the geometric model into the fabrication setting. So here we select a specific printer to be used to produce this model and process the geometry in all the possible ways so that this geometry can be built with the printer at hand. The final goal of this work package is to produce a sequence of machine instructions that the machine will use to fabricate the object. But before going to the fabrication, to the actual fabrication, we perform another simulation, which is represented by this WP4 here, thermal and stress analysis. So here we take these machine instructions and simulate the printing process. And here, differently from the other work package, we simulate the mechanical and thermal behavior of the process during of the object during its printing stage. So it's a dynamic simulation. The object is at each timestamp is incomplete, so its behavior is very different from the behavior of the bulk object. And if we detect that something goes wrong, so for example, the object deforms too much during the printing, and this might cause a failure of the printing process, we will go back before the actual printing to the process planning stage. And here we can try to reorient the object, to change the support structures and so on, to prevent the defect. When you are done, we pass to the actual manufacturing, and then we can pass through additional finishing operations. So the product that is built after the additive manufacturing is not the final product. It has to be finished, for example, to make some of the surfaces smooth and shiny through standard milling machine. Okay, so my institution participates in this project in these two phases. So our group in Pavia is working on the analysis-based design, and my own group in Genova is working on the process planning step. To show why this is so important, we have two industrial partners that bring two use cases to the project. The first is a company located in Italy that has patented this new gear, the one on the left. This is a particularly interesting object because it's capable of reducing speed of factors up to 3001 in a very small space. But the problem is that it's extremely difficult to be fabricated with standard technology. So they are very interested in using AM, using additive manufacturing to produce these parts. The problem is that friction here is an intrinsic issue because gears must must move one together with the other, and friction is not cannot be tolerated. The other partner that we have is a French partner, Novacra. They are specialized in producing injection molds, and as you know, when you produce a part by injection molding, it is very important to cool the plastic, to cool the material very quickly. So what is currently done is, well, they just take the mold and drill some pipes within the mold so that they can pour very cold liquid in that, and this makes the solution. Of course, this is suboptimal, and we wish to have another solution like the one on the right so that the pipes are, well, they move around the shape, and this can realize a quite quicker cooling down system, which is important for the quality of the resulting prints. Then we also have a Norwegian partner, which is the Stormwood Engineering. They own an industrial 3D printer, and they will try to produce these pieces. They also bring us a lot of competences over this list. So, what are we talking about here? The process planning is the sequence of operations of individual manufacturing operations needed to produce a given part of product. It's not novel, it has been around for decades now. With standard fabrication technologies, you just need to cast the geometric model into the fabrication technologies. This means that if you have an object made an assembly of various parts, you have first to locate the parts that you can buy from stock. You don't want to create screws and bolts and bevel gears. Those are bought. Other parts need to be printed. And then you have to select the proper fabrication tool to print the single parts, tune the fabrication tool, and that's all. This is what is known as process planning. Clearly, when you deal with additive manufacturing technologies, this whole process is much easier. You have less constraints. First of all, the printing machine has not problem of the occlusions that with standard CNC milling you will face. So it's quite, the process becomes quite easy. You start with a smooth surface made with a CAD model, then we tessellate it, you produce a triangle mesh. Starting from that, you produce a sequence of slices, and if you're very happy, you produce the G-code. And in the end, what you get is this. So unfortunately, printing fails, and especially if you print on metal, these failures cost you a lot of time and a lot of money. So what we are really trying to do in our project is to bring everything to a simulation. So we simulate, we simulate the behavior of the object as a whole and the behavior of the object as it's being printed. If something goes wrong, we want to know it in advance before starting the printing process. Here we have to face a lot of challenges. The first one is all our processes must be interoperable with each other. As you know, current softwares to design models are, well, produce smooth nerves, softened surfaces, Bezier patches, and stuff like that. But when you enter the realm of process planning, the so-called computer-aided manufacturing, the CAM, you switch to these STL files, these triangulated surfaces. And well, if you want to simulate the behavior of the model, you have to convert these surfaces into volumetric meshes that undergo some finite element simulation. Well, so you have a lot of different representations that, in our case, must talk to each other, and it's very hard. All of this stuff must be suitable for our process planning. Must be suitable for thermal stress analysis, and we must adapt to the design changes if the designer modifies the geometry. We have to adapt all our conversion to machine instructions, and of course, this is a process that takes time. So we want the user to be involved as less as possible. So we want to produce as automatic as possible process planning solutions. During our project, we had interviewed our industrial partners, and we also had done research in the literature. And all the sources quite agree that these are the main steps of the process planning pipeline. And it's quite important at the beginning to check the geometry and possibly repair it, because surprisingly, most of the models that you can find on the internet do not bound solid objects. This is an issue, because a printer can just print solids. So you can find models with self-intersections, with degenerate triangles, a big set of defects that you have to fix before printing. Then you have to find an orientation to put the object in the building chamber. We have to possibly design support structures if you have overhangs or other problems to solve. You have to slice the geometry in the most appropriate manner, and you have to set the manufacturing parameters. We are printing on metal, so we have to select the speed of the laser, its intensity, and all these things have consequences in the quality of the final manufactured product. So our industrial partner, the Drone Road Engineering, those who own the printer, they own this EOS M280 printer. They use Siemens NX to produce the design model, the CAD model. So they possibly add machining allowance at the beginning. This is due to the fact that if you, in the end, need to refine the geometry by CNC milling, you have to produce something which is a little bigger than expected by additive manufacturing, because you need to have some material to remove in the end. So this is a sort of offsetting of the geometry that you do at the beginning. Then you can possibly orient the part in this software and tessellate it. When you have the tessellation is switched to this other software, which is Materialize Magix, this provides some tools to repair the geometry. This partner say that they do not work. So the user has to intervene, and this is a quite complicated task, especially if one is not a technical. You have to know exactly what you are doing. Then if you didn't done that with the previous software, you have to orient the part you're in, and you have to add the support structure. In this case, this is a sort of art in this kind of manufacturing technologies, and then you have to slice the model. When you have the slices, you again switch to another software, which is on the printer. There is a PC mounted on the printer, and here you take your set of slices, you move them in the right position in the building chamber, and then you just push play and see what happens. So what I was saying, automatic methods do not work in other cases. That's quite difficult. Assigning proper support structures is a sort of art today, especially when you deal with metal printing. When you support structures here are not only there to support overhanging geometries, but they are also necessary to keep the geometry in its current shape. Because when you print on metal, there is a very strong tension that tends to deform the object as you are printing. So supports here really keep the shape in its position. And unfortunately, up to today, this is up to the operator. It's, as I said, it's a sort of art. There is a meltdown because, this metal printing, the principle is a laser that fuses metal particles, but the laser has a power, so it doesn't fuse only the particles where it is, but, the layers below the one you are fusing, are deformed. So if you're printing very thin features, these are probably distorted. We need to predict all these possibilities. Well, we also did the same investigation from a consumer's perspective, and things are even worse because we have less technical skills in this set of persons. So let's say what we are going to do, we are doing something in this direction. What I'm presenting here is an ongoing project, so I'm not presenting results, or not completely at least, but mainly ideas and ongoing work. So the first issue here is about the interoperability. What happens typically here is that if you when you pass from design to process planning, we are casting the geometry into a fabrication setting. And so we are, the first step here is we must verify that this design can be actually printed with this printer. For example, if you have a too thin wall, which is below the resolution of the printer, you have to detect it. The fact is that if during the process planning you do such an analysis on an STL, you have to then go back to the smooth representation, the NURBS that the designer is using, because the designer has to thicken this wall, and this link is not there. So this is a real problem. There is this so-called STL wall that neatly separates these two words, and it's an issue. What we are doing in our project here is to, we studied this annotation mechanisms. All the representations that we are using remain as they are because we want to be compatible with the outer world, but all the entities are linked with each other. So for example, each single NURBS patch in the design model at tessellation step is linked to all the triangles that represent it in the STL file, and vice versa. So what this means that when you detect a thin wall on the STL file, you can retrieve the same information on the same part of the smooth geometry so that the designer can take countermeasures. This is quite complicated, but we are going to actually implement this. At my institutions, we are developing this library that can represent partitioned and annotated 3D meshes, both surface meshes and volume meshes, because we need both of them. And we are going to implement a lot of algorithms orientation, mesh repairing, support structure creations, and all this stuff. And all these services are being uploaded on the Kaxman cloud. So don't get scared, but this is the most complicated slide of the talk. I will stay here for a couple of minutes, but it's just a matter of graphics. It's not that complicated. This describes mainly what we are actually doing in our workflow for process planning. So the red ellipses up there is the design phase. So we get an annotated model from it. We first check that this model can be printed, has the overall characteristics which are necessary to reprint it. For example, it cannot be larger than the printing chamber. This is a check that we do. if all these absolute checks succeed, we go and we enter the orientation loop, which means that we try to optimize for some measure, for example, the total area of the overhanging parts of the shape. If this is compatible again with the geometry of the printing chamber and with the characteristics of the printer, we proceed again. Otherwise, we try other orientations, so we loop until convergence. Then we create the support structures. Then we go to the slicing part. And after the slicing, we pass control to the simulation that simulates how the printing proceeds. If it fails, so if it succeeds, we go to the printer and that's it. If it fails, we pass control to the user. In this case, the user is able to see where the object being printed will have problems and can take countermeasures. So this is the only point, this interactive service is the only point in the whole workflow where the user is called into play. Okay, I will save some time here. Okay. Support structures are created as additional triangles, so these are quite easy for now. As I said, they should be enough to keep residual stresses into tolerable limits. And in the end, they will be sliced together with the original geometry to produce the printing path. Then we have this slicing. We take the tessellated geometry, and we have here we have developed two softwares here. One just to extract the slices from the tessellated model. The other one is to produce the volumetric mesh that simulates that serves for the simulation process. This is something we are working on now with Chino. We are taking the slices, and starting from them, we extruded each slice on the vertical position so that we build the layer, and within that layer, we produce a volume mesh. This is very useful to simulate because these elements are aligned with the slices and can be used to perform finite element analysis. This is what our simulation package will give us as feedback. We will analyze it mostly manually. This is where the user is called into play. So there is a viewer that shows what's going on, and the user here can change orientation, add support structures, and so on as is necessary, and can try another loop. So to conclude, what we are doing in this project is to create as automatic as possible process planning workflows. We are still open to user interaction because we admit that completely automatic is something which is not really feasible, at least not today. We are implementing real interoperable services. Here we are contributing to the development of new standards within STEP, and in particular within the application protocol 242, because we are, our annotation mechanism seems to be implementable within the STEP protocol through association of elements. So all the representations are stored together in the same file, let me say that, and kept aligned. So just to summarize, we perform simulation at design time, right before fabrication, and if everything is okay, the process planning we are implementing now is completely automatic. Okay, this concludes my talk. This work has been done together with the colleagues that you say, and I thank you for the attention. Mm-hmm.